Senator Bill Cassidy joining us this morning. Sir, good morning.
Hey, good morning, Bernadette. How are you?
I'm doing just great this morning. All right, so Senator, a lot of people are asking questions about more money for small businesses. So what can you tell us right now about this process?
Mm-hmm. So supposedly a deal has been achieved, but frankly, until it's voted on, right, we don't know it. Pelosi and Schumer will always pull back at the last minute, hoping as they play with Americans' lives, they can get a little bit more for their agenda. So hopefully it goes through today, but until it does, I don't know for sure that they'll keep their word.
Yeah.
You know, I'm curious in sort of talking about this next wave. Do you anticipate there will be any protections? You know, a lot of these large chains, you know, were criticized. We even know one of them, Shake Shack, returned the money because we know the money ran out. It wasn't as if everyone got it along with these large businesses. A lot of these large businesses got it and small businesses did not. Do you anticipate more strict regulations on who can get this next round?
I think the regulations will remain. Let me start over. The Treasury Department puts out those rules, so I can't tell you for sure whether or not it will change. But I will point out that there are some high-profile. Ruth's Chris's, for example, got $20 million. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the average loan size in Louisiana was about $150,000. So yes, high-profile got it, but the kind of overwhelming majority of businesses were small businesses. Mm-hmm. I think there's been about $5 billion given out in Louisiana when I checked those statistics. And I can shoot those to you if you want to post them on your website.
Yeah.
Or we'll post them on ours, cassidy.senate.gov.
But, you know, and I will say this. I mean, even in reading the story at the first time, okay, even if these large chains did get it, they still do employ people at the local level. So, you know, even though, like you said, high profile, they are these huge mm-hmm. businesses. Well, the bigger the business, you would think the more the employees, but I just think people were probably a little bit perturbed by that, but I think the addition of more resources will help. What else have you been working on up there?
Yeah, so we got to get out of this. What is the off-ramp between everybody locked down, unable to work, and getting back?
Yeah.
Now, that involves a lot of things. We've been working in the oil and gas industry, for example. Right now, they got a double hit. They got a hit between the Russians and the Saudi price war and a decrease of demand, so-called demand destruction. What can we do to support those oil and gas industries? I was on the phone call last night with the Secretary of Energy at like 10 o'clock at night. He's looking for ways of how we can increase storage, otherwise increase the price, otherwise preserve the employment in the oil and gas industry. That's one thing we're working on. Secondly, when all this is through, governments, local government's going to be bankrupt. So if you think about it, you can have a small business ready to go, but if trash is not getting picked up and there is no fire service and there is no police support, then still your economy is going to be wounded terribly. So also working on how do we support municipal government when we get restarted so that they can support the small businesses so that they can employ people. We're working on that as well. And then lastly, what do we do about knowing when it's safe to go back to work? Turns out if you look at people less than 49, if they're otherwise healthy, they have an extremely low risk of death, extremely low risk. And so is there a way that we can start working our economy back up with those who are at lower risk for whatever reason, and those who are at higher risk will know they're at higher risk. They may stay indoors or in social distancing, but we can begin to reopen with those who are much lower risk.
Is there anything you can do? We had in our newscast this morning in the Los Angeles County area where they are, it seems like, aggressively rolling out these antibody tests that they believe they could have hundreds of thousands of people who have already had this, obviously didn't have the severe cases and in some cases didn't have any symptoms at all. But, you know, it might shed more light on that. However, we know the antibody testing, at least at this point in our state, I mean, I know of one lab 2 hours away that you can walk in and do it. Is there anything we can do to direct those antibody tests down here so people can get back to work?
Great question.
So the problem with the antibody test is there's not one that has been totally validated that is being used on a widespread scale. Mm-hmm. By that, I mean there's different types of coronavirus. So you measure the coronavirus antibody, you got to make sure it's for this coronavirus, not for another coronavirus. Mm-hmm. And there's a way to do that, but you got to make sure that your antibody test is actually doing that. So far, it's kind of hit or miss as to whether or not the antibody tests out there mm-hmm. are actually measuring immunity as opposed to just measuring the fact that you had a cold 2 years ago and you still have a little bit of antibody to that cold.
Yeah.
I'm a big believer, by the way, in establishing immunity. I did a lot of immunization work back when I taught with LSU Med School, and I'm a big believer, but we got to make sure that we do it right and know for sure that if somebody has the antibody, they're immune.
Yeah, I don't know if anybody really kind of thought about that, but gosh, that is so straight to the heart of it because, what if you did have a cold 2 years ago and it was a, there it was, and you're going to possibly have antibodies from that. So how do we know? Mm-hmm. These are all good questions. Boy, this balance, this dance that we're playing with all of the different aspects of this coronavirus and this, as it becomes COVID-19 infection, if you get it. God, your perspective, your mind must be going at a million miles a minute all the time, Senator.
I told my wife I never sleep well at night because I always wake up at 2 a.m. thinking about something on it.
Yeah.
But I tell folks that our approach has to be what we call the if and then but. If I am 25 years old and I'm otherwise healthy, then I'm really at low risk of having any problems from coronavirus. But if I get infected, I can infect other people. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. If I am 55 years old and I have diabetes, I am at high risk, then I am at high risk of having complications, but if I take precautions, I'll be okay. So for everybody, it's going to be an if and then but, and you got to figure out your own personal risk, and frankly, we have to do that for society too.
I was going to say, and you also have to plan for the people who aren't going to pay attention, who aren't listening right now to what you're saying, and who are, kind of willy-nilly out there, not wearing masks and doing different things. We have to wrap up with you, quickly for time, but I do want to just ask, because I think one of the more unfortunate things, we've seen so many great things happening in our area and across the country. One of the more unfortunate things, I think, in one of the pictures I saw that really depicted this is, the protests that are happening against the stay-at-home orders. And I think it was in Denver where you had members of, a medical team at a hospital nearby walking down there, and it's like they're facing off. You have the medical team who's saying, look, I'm out here doing it. I'm seeing it up close and personal. But then you have to understand also why people don't want to be at home anymore. As a member of the medical community yourself, and I know you're a senator now, but I know you keep up with things and you're a doctor. How do you feel about that?
So that goes back to financial and physical health. You have to have a balance. If somebody is seeing a small business they put their life savings into totally evaporate, they're going to be frustrated.
Yeah.
The way we have to address this is with science. Okay, we can show you that you're at risk because of this. Therefore, please be a little bit more patient. On the other hand, we can see that you're not at risk. We can give you more freedom. Let some of that steam off of that pressure cooker. If you let that steam off appropriately, guided by science, hopefully we can balance it, Goldilocks just right.
U.S. Senator Bill Cassidy, always with some great insight.
Yeah,
I mean, on
so many
different
levels,
topics, from healthcare and Obamacare,
those
things we've talked to you about. But this one really hits home. Thanks so much for your time and be in touch. We appreciate it.
Hey, thank you all. Be safe.
You too, sir.